Good day to you. Yeah, this is good news. Great here, and from FCF, First Class Foundation. And I'm going to be putting you through Visual Basic, specifically how to go about the episode 1-3 assignment you were given. The first question, you were told to write a program to calculate the semester grade point average for a university student, and the program should be able to accept the student's full name, faculty, department, matriculation number and year. It should be able to accept from the student or user a maximum of 8 courses and corresponding units. Students should be able to enter a score for each of the course taken. Finally, the program should be able to give the students full details as well as the Sgpa accurate to 2 decimal places. The program should be developed in Visual Basic and should have a graphic user interface. I'm sure you already have the question. So this is just like a picture of what you are required to do. Now this is the graphic user interface that you are seeing. That's why you see form design. And this is the codes. These are the codes that are implementing the program, such that when the student fills in the necessary details, it's able to bring the results as the semester GPA accurate to 2 decimal places as you are required. Now, so let me run this to see what we are going to be doing. So this is how the program will run. The student types in his details. Let's call the name of the student BC, the matric number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So the department, for example, business administration. The level 100, semester first. The way I designed this particular SGPA calculator, it will request for the number of courses taken, and based on that, it will provide the fields for the details for those courses. So if the student is offering 7 courses, for example, it provides fields for 7 courses, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. If the student is offering 5, you see the fields for 5 courses. And also, I designed it in such a way that once the student types in a score, the grade automatically appears. Although some of these things are not required, and I may not necessarily put you through doing some of this in order to save time, but then these are some of the things you can explore in Visual Basic. It's important to let you know that the codes I use in implementing this are very basic codes. Yes, but the implication of that is that you have a long lines of code, but then it's something that it's very much easy to be understood. If you meet a computer science student, they'll definitely do it shorter, but then with a little more complexities if you're not familiar with it at all. So let's assume the student has these grades. I'll be leaving out the course code, and okay, I actually have to provide the units, else the program won't run. So let's just say these are the grades of a particular student within this matric number. And so I put in course code 2, 4, 3. So if I click on this calculate button, it calculates the CGPA, the SGPA rather, and brings out this box saying that the FBC is Student of Business Administration Department. Your SGPA for 100 level 4 semester is 4.07. You have the second class upper SGPA. Yes, you're required to provide the results stating the student's name and the student's full details and the SGPA to two decimal places. So this is what we're required to do, but the second class upper is, well, not necessary, but my addition. So these are some of the things that we'll be doing. Now, if I click this clear all, it clears everything and this, you are required to fill afresh. And if I click cancel, it exits the program. So now we are told that it should accept a maximum of 8. So if a particular student enters 9 courses, we can see that it's saying the number of courses must be less than or equal to 8. So these are some of the things that are into this. I may not go in depth into all of this because we don't have all the time for that, but then the basic that will require you to arrive at the answer and the solution required from you, we'll be looking at that today. So once I press cancel, it exits the program and I'm back to my design page. So let's start from the scratch. So I believe you should have Visual Studio installed on your PC. It might be a newer version, but all the same, this is likely to be how the home page will be for you. And so we start by clicking New Project. So we are programming in Visual Basic, and that's why Visual Basic is selected. There are other programming languages supported by this software, Visual Studio. So when you select Visual Basic, we are using Windows Forms application. So this allows us to have a graphic user interface, because we are told that the program should have graphic user interface. So once I click that, I can type the name of the project. So, and let me call that SGPA calculator. Tutorial. So, and then I click OK. So this is what comes up first. First, I see the form design. I'm required to design the form that I am using. So what I can do is to expand this to create more space for me to work with. So once I have this, now if you look at this particular window you see here, there are different panels. If you are familiar with applications on computer, you would know that this is always a regular panel, file, edit, and all of that. So this is the toolbox. This is something that will be very new. And this here is the properties. So these are the two areas you'll really be dealing with, the tools and the properties. So, first of all, I would like to change this from one to what I'm actually doing. So, once I go to my properties, I see different categories: accessibility, appearance, behavior, and all of that. Under the appearance, we see the back color. I can change so many things here, but I will try to be leaving it very simple. The background color, I can change the color from this to something else. There are various options of colors depending on what I want, but I'll leave it as what it is. Then I can add a background image. If I don't want a plain background, I can add a background image. When I was in 100 level, I was required to actually design an ATM machine, and I'll kind of show you, although I don't have the code here, but I'll show you how it looked like. I added a background image to it. If you can see this Word document, you see different images. So what you see behind is Gbank, and that's a background image I added. I designed that and added it as a background image instead of having the regular plain background. So back to our form, I'm not going to add any background image. I'm not changing anything. What I want to change is this form one, and it is in this text part. So the text is what the form is bearing. So I can change this to SGPA calculator. So once I see that is reflected here. So now, because we are using GUI, you are required to design your interface the way you want, and that's why we are changing the name, the background color, and all of that. So, and there are three main items you are going to be using in this toolbox for designing our interface. The first we are going to be using is label, the second we'll be using is text box, and the third is button. There are other things you could use, but those are the three that we are going to be using for this project. So now, when you go to your toolbox, you might not see everything the way it is. You likely see it like this. So once you click on this arrow here, it brings down the all Windows form tools here. So I see different pointer buttons and all of that. So we're using, like I said, we're using label, text box, and button. So now let me search for label and drag it. Now there's no hard and fast rule on how your interface should look like, so you have to design it the way it pleases you. Now it's reading label one, but what I want this label to be, what a label is basically an uneditable text. So it displays a text which the user cannot edit. Probably you want to use it as your field name or the title of the project or whatsoever. So that's what a label is. Now, instead of label one, I want it to have a different title. I want to use this as the title, SGPA calculator. So that's what I want it to be. So I'll go back to my properties. This is where I can adjust all that under the appearance, like we did for the form itself. The label, I select the label and go to appearance, text, and I change this to SGPA calculator. You can write it in full, you can use any other thing. Now I feel this is too small, so I want to edit the font. Once I click on font, it's still under appearance. So once I click on font, I can edit it. I'll use bold and just increase the font to 16 and click OK. I think it's a bit better, so I can use it like that. I won't be doing much work on the designs. You can explore all that yourself. You can actually change the font type you can change the font style and the font size too. So the other things I'll also be coming to later on. So this is the title. Now we're told that the program should accept the user's full name. So I'm going to add another label. Like I said, we use label for a field name, a title, whatsoever. So I'm going to change this from label to bear full name, all in caps. I can increase the size if I wish. I go to font, change the size to say 12. Let me reduce it to 11 so that I have space for other things. So that's the full name. Then first I'm going to be adding all the labels I need. It should also receive the student's faculty. So I change this, or rather than bringing the label one by one, I can duplicate the one I already have so that I don't have to be changing the appearance, the font size and all of that every time. So I'll just select the label and I want to duplicate, press Ctrl C and Ctrl V to copy and paste, then I drag it back so it maintains the same properties of that. Then I can just change what is in the faculty. So you would also do this for other details up to the matric number and year. So I'm going to speed up this video to save time. So we have all these fields that we require: full name, faculty, department, matriculation number, yeah, I added semester. You can choose to add it or not since it wasn't required. So now, these are the field names. If there's a field name, there has to be a place for the user to put in these details. Because once you receive from the user his full name, faculty, department, matric number, year and semester. So to do that, we are going to be bringing in text box is editable. I said label is not editable, it's just for the names, but text box is where the user can type fill in details that you require for the program to run. So still in the toolbox, we scroll up and we see text box. So I can drag or drop or double tap, whichever one you desire to use. So I would take it up here. The first I need is the full name. So if I want to edit this text box on all sides, you scroll up to the arrow we find here and check multi-line. So I can increase it on all sides. Can increase it on all sides to enable me edit it where I want, so whichever way you want it. So like I did for the others, I'll just duplicate, copy and paste and bring here. So I can also resize them because some of them are too big. Semester, you don't need to be that big. The year also, you don't need it to be that big. Your matric number can be smaller, department can be that, and those ones are okay. So now we have this also. Now it says that it should receive from the user the courses offered the scores and the corresponding units. So next, you are going to be, now it's still the same label and text box. So a label for the course, the score, and the course units. So I can pick any of these to duplicate to make my work easier. So I need 3. All I will have to do is to change the details. So, and then in text box under it, I can select one and paste, or you go to the toolbar and bring them up by yourself. So I'll have to put 8 text boxes because it should be able to accept up to 8. So for each of them, it has to be up to 8. So once you get that done for all of them, we come back. So let me help you. Now, since we are having 8 for each of the 3 categories, I just select all the 8. Copy and paste. So it duplicates the old 8. Then I just bring it and align it. I paste it again so I don't have to start doing them one after. So I have to start doing them one after the other. I hope that makes sense. So I didn't change these field names. So let this be the scores. This will be the course units. Just put units. And this, the course. So to make this a bit more presentable, I align them to the center of the text boxes. So I think for now that is okay. What I'm trying to actually do is to maximize the space. Like I said, your interface does not have to be exactly the way I did mine. You could decide to bring maybe the department beside, matric number beside, and all of that. So do it and let it be unique to you. I would encourage that. Let it be unique to you. So now that we have all these details, like I said, you can actually make adjustments to all of these things. Make adjustments to the font type, the appearance, and you can do that for the text box. If you want the fields to the text box to have a particular font that you love, just select the text box, come to appearance, and change the font. So when the user types in his details, it is based on the font you've selected that is going to appear. So that's the way it is. Now that we have this, it should also be able to, our program should be able to produce a result. Result as in the student's semester grade point. So I think I will need another text box. I believe you agree with me. So I copy one of them as usual and paste. So I can position it anywhere. So let's just have it down, and I would love to increase the height a bit. So, and a label to bear that this is the CGPA or SGPA rather. So I change this to what? SGPA. So now we already have our labels and text boxes. So we need buttons. Now, what are buttons meant for? Buttons are needed for actions, just the way it is on your phone, your mobile device, your computer. If you look at this, my window, there are buttons here. These three are buttons, actually. They are buttons. So just the same way I have an interface and I say, okay, on your calculator, you have buttons. When you press equals on your calculator, it means calculate. So we need buttons so that once those buttons are clicked on, an action takes place based on what you want it to be. So that's what we use buttons for. So we go back to our toolbox and click on button. I can just double tap, it appears in the form. Position it wherever I want and call it a name. So this first button, I want it to, once this button is clicked on, it should calculate the Sgpa. So I can just press change the name to calculate, so that the user sees it and knows that this is the calculate button. Once I press this, it's to give me a result. Now I think the text is too small. I would love to increase the button a bit more and change the text, embolden it. So bold, and increase it to say 12. And I'll have to expand this because it's small. So this can, it might not be okay for you. Now I forgot to tell you that, now you're wondering why I'm switching between this and that. Once you double tap on anything here, it opens up the form where you fill in your code. So that's what it is for. I would go to that later on. So I'm going to duplicate this button. I can have, let's say, 3. Like you saw in what I used to illustrate, I had 3 buttons. One was calculate, the other was clear all. And the other was cancel, in case I'm no more interested in calculating my CGPA or SGPA. So now we have all that we need basically. The other thing you saw in mine, which was not here, is the column for grade. I won't be putting that because there's a lot that goes into that and might not be necessary. If need be, I'll go back to mine and explain what I did there. And then there's a column I put there for number of courses taken. So first of all, let's start with the basics. We can always come back to add things to the form so that it doesn't get confusing for you. So now that we have this other thing, before we begin programming, there are certain things we need to do. One of which would enhance the user experience. Now, for me as a person, when I'm typing on a form, I use tabs to navigate to different fields. So once the person types in his full name, now let's run this code to see how it will appear to the user. You press F5 on your keyboard or go to or click start here. So once I click start, it opens it up the way it appears to the user. So this is the way the user sees it. Now if I'm typing, I use tab to navigate to the next field based on what I'm needing. So immediately I tap, press tab, now it's going to the last course unit. But I want it that once I tap and press tab from semester, it goes to the course, then to the units, then to the score, and goes like that line by line. So I don't have to be locating my mouse while typing. It's for a beautiful user experience actually. So I'm going to close this and go back to my phone. Now, how do I do that? Once I go back to my form, I select on each of the fields. Now, I'm not going to be selecting on labels. Why? Because the user cannot edit labels. So even if it's pressing tab, it's not going to arrive at any label. So I'll start from the first, which will assume the user types his full name first. Once I select on the text box, I go to my properties and scroll up to behavior. Then you see tab index is the number there is 7. So since why it is 7 is because I already have some labels being the tabs. So if I select on SGPA calculator 1 and I go to behavior, it has the first tab index 0, actually starting from 0. Then the next has the tab index of 1, then 2, then 3. It was based on the order at which I created the labels and the text box. That's what is having there. But now to edit it, so I'll start from the full name. I'll change the tab index to 0. I don't need tab index for the labels. So faculty, I change the tab index to 1, department 2, matric number 3. Ensure you are taking to account the order at which you are doing them. 4, semester in year, then semester 5. So then I go to the courses. The first course, I stopped at 5, right? So this would be 6. Then, like I said, I want to be going from so that you are filling details for each course. The next would be the units for that course, which would be number 7. Next would be number 8. That will be next year will be number 9. Then, so I do it like that for others. So after I've done for the last underscore, the calculate button, so I would love to use tab to navigate to that. So that will be the next button I'm navigating to. So, and I'm ending the last as 29. So calculate button will be 30. Then the next button, 31. Then I can have the SGP as 33, although I'm still going to do something to the SGP. Now, so we can check to see how the user experience is. Like I said, you use F5 on your keyboard or start. So let's just navigate with tabs. So as you can see, it's in the order of how we want it to be. So after this, it goes to calculate, clear or cancel the SGPA, then back to the full name. So that's how we want it to be. It's going to automatically skip the labels, because why, the labels cannot be edited. So if you are putting tab, the user cannot interact in any way with the labels. So then we close that. Now, this SGPA box, I'm going to do something to it, because I do not want the user to type in anything there. So I'm going to make it appear as a label. I can do that such that it is not editable. And I go back to behavior, and you see enabled here. I'm going to change it to false. So that means it is not enabled. If I press F5 to check it out, you can see that the SGPA box is not like others. Now it's a dark color as though it were a label. So that's what we want to achieve. Now we are not yet done. Before we begin programming, there's one important thing we must do. We need to give names to all of this. because we'll be referencing these names, and if you don't know the names that they have, how then do we interact with them the way we want it to be? So once you select on any of the fields, what I'm going to be giving names to are those things the user can interact with, because those are going to form the basis for which I am making it's going to form the basis for which I am programming and for which I'm designing my program, such that it's going to give me the solutions I want. Now, so I'll start with this full name and scroll up to design. Scroll up to design and you see name. This is the name that this text box is having, which when I go to this form is what I'm going to be interacting with. So I change the name to, like I said, go to design, change the name. Now, when you are filling in name, this is different from text, which is under the appearance, right? Yes, which is under the appearance. So under the design, you must not have space between whatever you're typing. So I'll just call this full name. Full name without space. I'll make it in title case full name. Then I go to the next one, faculty. So if I'm having more than one word in it, I'm not going to have space in between. If not, it's not going to accept that. So I call this department. I call this matric number. I call this the year. And I call this semester. Now for this course unit and score, I'm going to call it, let's say, courses, units, and scores. Then I'll be adding a number. This is 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So courses 1, scores units 1, scores 1. So I'll do that for the next. The next will be courses 2, units 2, scores 2. So you can do that for the others. So now that we've done that, we also give names to these buttons. I'll call this calculate button. I'll call this clear button. I'll call this cancel button. I'll also give name to this Sgpa text box. Let's call this Sgpa box. So now we've named all that. At this point, we can actually begin doing some programming. So the first we'll start with is the buttons. Now, what we are doing next is to tell the computer what to do when these buttons are actually clicked on. So if I try to run the code F5, if I press the calculate button, clear button, cancel, nothing is being done. So, like I said, the buttons are more like telling the computer to take an action. So once these buttons are clicked, there's an action that you must have programmed to that button. That is what the computer will carry out. So to help us, I'll start with this cancel button. Now, just double click on the button. It takes you to its section on the code. So you can see a private sub ca cancel button underscore click, meaning that once that button is clicked, whatever you write under is going to take place. And when we cancel, when the user clicks cancel, we want this program to close. So what we are going to do is to type application. Dot exit. It actually gives suggestions, so once you see the suggestion, you can move to the next. So I'll type it again, assuming you didn't see that. Application dot exit. Once I see the thing selecting on a particular one, and that's what I want, I click that. So let's run the code and see. F5. So if I click cancel, you can see that it closes off the program. I'll do it again. Once I click cancel, the program closes. That's what I asked it to do. I believe that's very clear. So the next thing, because the calculate button is where most of the work is, so I'll go to this clear all. Now I want everything to be cleared, whatever it has been typed inside, to clear once this button is clicked. So I'll double click on this button to specify the actions to take place. Now, that's why I said it was important for us to give these things names. So I'll be able to refer to is that okay, computer, clear the full name box, the faculty box, department box, matric number, and all of that. So, like I said, we are using very simple and basic codes. So I'm going to type full name, which is the name I gave it, dot clear, and press enter. So the next field is what? Faculty. And that's why it's good to name it with something you can easily identify, although the computer will give you suggestions as you start typing. So if I, let's say I name this with another thing, maybe F, another thing that starts with maybe another letter. Now it will be very difficult for me to identify it. So next is faculty. So you can see it suggested dot clear. The next is what? Department dot clear. Matric number dot clear. Year dot clear. Semester dot clear. It automatically adds those brackets, so you don't have to worry about that. Then the other text box, we have that for the we have that for the courses, the units, and the scores. So I'm going to type courses 1 dot clear, courses 2 dot clear, sorry, course 3 dot clear, courses 4 dot clear. So I'm going to do that up to 8. So I do that for the units also. Units 1 dot clear. Units 2 dot clear. So I've done that for both the units and the courses. Now you can check the code to see if it works. So let's just type anything in each of So I've filled all the columns. Once I click clear all, you can see it clears everything. It clears everything. So I can press the cancel and it exits. So another thing we're supposed to also clear is the Sgpa box. Why? Because if the person has calculated before and clears everything, the Sgpa box also should be cleared. The solution that has been gotten previously should be cleared. So Sgpa box dot clear. So here we are. Now we've done that for those buttons. So the next thing we need to do now is to actually calculate the Sgpa. These other things are just extras. So if you have all these things and your Sgpa calculator cannot calculate Sgpa, all you've just done is exercise. You just set it to play with Visual Studio. So that's it. Now so we are going to do something now. First of all, let's double click on the calculate button. And we see it taking us to the subform for the that belongs to the button, the calculate button, although it's still reflecting button one because that was the name it was called before we actually renamed it. So but then it doesn't affect the program. So we are going to actually do something now in calculating the Sgpa. We need the computer to extract whatsoever the user has typed in each of these boxes, because those are what we are going to need. And to make it easier for us, we are going to give names to whatever values would come from these boxes. I believe that's clear. So we are going to give names to whatsoever values would come from these boxes. And so we named this units one, and that's why I decided that we should add an S, because we would also name it after the word unit, but there will be no S. So we are going to say that we only need for the unit and the score. So units Now, first of all, to help us, we go to the public class form one, and we are going to define values. We are going to call something certain names. Since we already know the names, we are calling them. I'm going to be calling what is coming from this unit one, unit two, unit three, without an S, and from here score one, score two, score three, score four, whatever you can call it. But this is what I would call it. You can call it something else, maybe whatever it is, yeah, course unit one, course unit two, whichever is convenient. You can add your own form of uniqueness to it, but then it should be something that will not be difficult for you to follow through and remember while programming. So we are going to be defining the values now. I want to call them those names. And while I'm defining them first, that is even going to help me while typing them. So I'm going to say dim. Dim is the word used for defining. You can see it says dim statement declares and allocates storage space for one or more member field. So we are going to declare unit one. I will just use a comma. That way it's It makes my work easier. Unit 1, Unit 2, Unit 3, Unit 4, Unit 5, Unit 6, Unit 7, Unit 8 as integer. Now, what is an integer? An integer is a whole number, meaning that the unit that will be provided must be a whole number. If it's not an whole number, your program will actually not run. So the scores also. So we are going to use score 1, score 2, score 3. Like I said, we are not adding S. So we can actually give a location for where the score is in decimals by defining it as double. So let's start with these two for now. We'll still have to define some other things which we'll be using later on. So we go back to the sub for the button. So we are going to say that unit 1 is equals to value, then in open brackets, the box that houses what the value of unit 1, that's unit 1 dot text. So unit 2 equals to value unit 2 dot text. Unit 3 equals to value I believe what I'm doing is actually clear. So you go ahead up to unit 8. You go ahead up to unit 8. So I do that for the score. So I say score 1 equals to the value in units, in scores rather, scores 1 dot text. Soon equals to value in scores. So So I've done that for both. Now when I press the calculator button, the computer is going to extract the value in those ones, and they'll be treated as a string. It's important you put the value there, so you want the value. You know that there are weights to integers, not just the text that is there, but the value is 23 if it is treated as a string, as a double, as you see it here. It takes the value that is in there. You did place value in mathematics, so it's able to capture the weight that certain value has, or the text box carries, the value in the text box carries. So that's what we are doing here. Now I think from here we can actually go into calculating, but to make our calculation easier, we would actually do it in steps. We know that to calculate your semester grade point, you would have to calculate the weight, that is the cost, the grade times the points times the units divided by the sum of the points times the units divided by the total cost units. That is, if you have an A, it is 5 points, B 4 points, C 3 points, and like that. So you multiply that by the unit to get your grid point. Actually, I believe I'm making sense. So the grid point, that's the point for that particular grid, then you total it up to get the total grid point, then divide by the total units to get your grid point average, GPA. So that's what we are going to do. We are going to do it in steps. So we want it to so we want the computer to be able to detect the point for whatever score is being imputed. So if the individual scores 70 and above, it's going to be what? It's going to, the point is going to be 5. So what we are going to do now is to, and now we are going to use another name. So what we are going to do is to define that name we are using. So let's call them grade points. So to actually save time, we will actually be calculating the grade point directly. So meaning that if a person scores 70 and above, you are going to multiply the unit for that course by 5. If it is 61 to 69 or 60 to 69, it's going to be the unit times 4. So we are going to be calling that grade point, the point for that particular grade that the individual gets. So what we are going to do is to define grade point, because it's going to be for each of the courses. So if the person has a, if the person is offering 8 courses, so there will be grade points for each of the courses. We'll now get the total grade points, and then the semester GPA by dividing by the total units. So let's call this grade points 1. Let me actually use all lowercase. As integer, so we are defining it as integer. Then since we are going to calculate total grade points, let's define that also. Total remember your the name must not have space in between. You know, it's a treat that are so different two different values. Total grade points as integer. So next, now we are going to use an if command. You know that we say that if you know that if is a conditional statement, that if certain thing exist, then this is what the computer should do. So you are saying that if score one is greater than or equal to, so these are right greater than or equal to 70, and then it's between 70 and 100, so that if the user does not input a value that is greater than 100, it does not calculate a grade point of that. So 70 and the same score one, you have to spell it out again. Score one is less than or equal to 100. Then we go to the next line actually to specify what should be done. Then total grade points one is going to be equal to the unit one, the units for that score, for the course that the student had a score, multiplied by 5. We denote multiplication with asterisk. Else, if, because we are specifying another condition, the difference between else and else if. Else is like, if that does not happen, then do this. But else, if you are trying to say if that does not happen, then check out another condition. So else if score one is greater than or equal to 60 and score one is less than or equal to 69, then the grade point one will be equal to unit one, times 4. Then else if, so we do that up till we get to F. So I've done that for this, so I'm going to do it for the next score. For score 2 up to score 8, so it will be, instead of grade point 1 or grade point 2 when it's 2, grade point 3 when it's 3. So there's going to be an end if after each of the conditions. So this is actually the most time consuming of all. I think once you are done with this, we have just a very short work to do left, because we've calculated the grade point. The next is to calculate total grade point. So I know that total grade point is going to be the sum of all the grade points, grade point 1 to grade point 8. So it's equals to grade point 1 plus grade point 2 So grade point 1 plus grade point 2 plus grade point 3. I think I have grade point 3 duplicated. Grade point 1 plus grade point 2 plus grade point 3 plus grade point 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 7 plus 8. So you must be careful not to make mistakes, as if you make mistakes in your programming, is either the program doesn't run or it gives you a wrong solution. So like now the added grade point 3 again is going to definitely calculate the Sgpa wrongly. So now that we've done this, the Sgpa is going to be what? The total grade points divided by the course units. the total units. So I can just say, let's say total units, but I've not defined that. So let me define total units. I want to use the total units, another variable. I'm defining my variables. So no variables are variables are when you have, you say x plus y equals to z, or x plus y equals to 2. When you have that, x and y, they are variables, meaning that the values they carry could change. So that's why I'm defining them. So total units, I'm defining total units, then total units as integer. So from there I can now come back to where I stopped and say that total units will be equal to units 1 plus units 2 plus units 3 plus units 4 plus units 5 plus units 6 plus units 7 plus units 8. So you know that our GPA or SGPA, let's call it GPA, will be equal to, we've not defined it, so let's define GPA. Now we're going to define this as double dim GPA as double. So we go back there and say that the GPA is going to be equal to the total grid points divided by, we denote division by the slash, divided by total units. So basically we've actually calculated the GPA. Now what we're going to now do is that whatever the computer gets as GPA would be put into the SGPA box. So you know that SGPA box dot text. So the text that that thing will carry, because the text box, will be the what, GPA. So let's try to run this. So for now we can skip the full name and all of that and just put units and scores. So once you click calculate, you can see that it actually calculated the GPA. But now what it's calculating is not to two decimal places, because we're required to calculate that to two decimal places. So if I clear all, you can see that those other things we've done before. So what I'm going to do now is to say GPA before the SGPA box of text, and say GPA is equals to maths dot round, then we open a bracket GPA, then a comma and two. So what I'm trying to say is that this GPA should be rounded up to two decimal places. So let's run it again and see how far. So if you click calculator, you can see that now the SGPA is 2 decimal places. So what you can do is to actually confirm if it's calculated correctly, so that we are sure that our program is actually working very well. So if it does not calculate it correctly, it means that we made a mistake somewhere down the line. So you can check if this is actually correct. If it's not, then you probably made a mistake. Then you just check your code. Maybe the maybe your variables, you misplaced them or put them in the wrong positions. But I'll actually assume that mine is correct, so we save time. So we can see that that is done. Now one more thing before we round up. We are told that it should give the students full details with the GPA to two decimal places. So like I showed you from mine that I had done previously, that it is going to bring out a box and tell us that this is so so and so, you add a semester GPA of this. So that's actually what we seek to achieve. So and that box is called a message box. So now the message box is going to tell us the student's name. It's going to tell us, let's say, the department and the level and semester. Just like I said the previous one, we said this person from this department had your first semester GPA, your undergraduate first semester GPA is so. You had a first class SGPA. So let's say that's what we want to do. That box is called a message box. So it needs to be based on conditions, since we are going to specify, that's if you are going to actually specify the kind of result the person has, whether it's a first class or other ones. So if we are not going to put the kind of result, whether it's a first class or second class or whatsoever, what we'll just do is message box, MSG box. Then we open a bracket. We want it to say dear the person's first name, right? So if his name is Joseph, dear Joseph, your under level first semester, that's the year, under level first semester SGPA is this. So what I'm going to type is, the day is fixed because it's not going to depend on what the full name is. So I'm going to put that in inverted commas, that's quotation marks. So dear, then I'm putting plus because it's going to add to this dear the full name. So full name dot text, full name dot text, then plus of so department. So we say dear and the full name of that person, if the person's name is Joseph for example, then of the person's department. So whatever the department has been imputed in the form is what we are going to have to put here. So we are going to use department plus department dot text, then plus of, if you put accounting, so it's going to be accounting department, or we can choose to leave it out. So accounting department, your write your the semester the person, the level the person puts there, the year. That will be year.txt. Then level. So if you put 100, it's going to have 100, which is what they put there. Then it adds the string level to it. Then the semester, whatever the person puts there, semester. Semester dot text. So ensure you are putting plus once you are transiting from the string that is fixed to the variable which you are getting from the form. So semester dot text plus a string semester. Now I'm actually getting this very clearly is because I've done it before. So if you are doing it for the first time, you might have to do it and preview and edit until it gives you the perfect picture that you want. Semester. So if you put first semester, first, what if you put first, it's going to put first year, then semester. You can actually continue your semester results or SGPA. SGPA is then we add as SGPA box dot text. SGPA box dot text. So we close the brackets. So let's look at how it is. Let's say Joseph is the name and the faculty is what? Management Sciences. Department. This is insurance. Matric number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. Year 100, semester first. So the course is not going to affect anything, so we can leave that for now. So let's just fix in scores arbitrarily. So press calculate. Now it says Dear Joseph of Insurance Department. So if you look at this, you can see that there is barely a space in this thing, and the reason is because of the addition between the string and the value we are getting from the form. So how we can address that is to put a space before the next one we are importing from the form. How do I mean? If we cancel, now when we come here, we see there, we need to put a space here first of all, because it's going to take the value there, and if the individual does not put space there, it's even not going to put a space. So assume that there's going to be a space before the full name we get. If you're going to type it actually fully, would have left a space, then on top the person's name. Then after the person's name, there is a space, so and that space is before the of. So I'll just be putting space until based on what I know it as. Now you can always go back and check until it's the perfect thing, perfect results that you desire. So basically what I'm putting space is, I'm putting space is actually before and after those the string. So you can take that as a clue. Then I actually want a full stop after everything. So I put plus, then inverted comma, then full stop. There doesn't have to be a space before the full stop, so that's fine. Let's check it out. So Joseph Faculty Management Sciences. So calculate. It says, Dear Joseph of Insurance Department, your 100 level first semester SGPA is 4.47. So that's pretty much what we desire to get, and that's what we've done. So okay, if the person decides to compute another person's SGPA, it clicks clear all, and if it chooses to exit, it presses cancel. So that's pretty much it. So that's like the basics of everything. If you want to decide that the message box will reflect the person's class, whether it's a first class or whatsoever, we'll now be using the conditional function using if. So this is what we'll be having if the GPA is greater than 4.5 and less than that, then it's going to put in this same text that we just add, but then there's an enter where you see BBCL CRLF, it's for enter, meaning that it's going to put what is next on a new line. So that's why you have this VB CRLF. So then he's now going to write you add a first class SGPA. So I actually see that working in the text, the one I showed you before we began doing this. So that's pretty much it for now. Like I said, there are other things you could do. For example, if the person inputs a score of a score that is less than 0 and greater than 100, you can have a message box telling the person that this value inputted is not valid for the calculation and all of that. So that's pretty much of it for now. Just the basics that you would need if you are going to be doing what is required of you for your exam. What I did was actually something like this when I was in year one. I don't think there was any much difference. I'm not even sure I actually added class to it, so just a simple work, and I add an A in the course. So basically they require that your program should be able to run and achieve what you are asked to do. The other things, the grade column is something that is not necessary. But then I can actually show you how to go about that just by mouth. And that's in this particular place. We see that if the score is greater than 70 and less than 100, greater than or equal to 70 and less than 100, you can now put that the grade is going to be in inverted column A. So, and I'll show you in the previous one, the one I showed you at the beginning of this class. So I believe that you should be able to attempt this and also explore into more of that. If you know what we're using this if for, you can use it for any other thing to get your values. I think there's one thing I would love to check and that is if the individual records less than 8 courses, whether or not it will calculate. So it's actually going to give us our solution whether or not the other columns are empty. So definitely the student can be offering only 7 and putting his values there. So that is all for now. For the second question, I might put up another video on that. That one is quite very much easier than this. This one is very easy, a bit complex because you're having many fields which you have to name and all of that, but that one is very much easier. I could just show you a preview of how that one is. So this is how the Pythagorean triple is. It's very much simple, and you can see the codes are very short. So what we were asked to do was you receive 2 integers, and from that you get a Pythagorean triple. We are given the formula we are going to use. So it's just the same way we use a formula for calculating our SGPA. We are going to do some of that. Although we use some other things to for some other reasons also, such that the program will be able to run very effortlessly. And if the user inputs some figures that are not valid, we would actually get to inform him that this input is not valid. So that is it for the SGPA calculator. Thanks for watching. Ensure you subscribe to this channel if you have not. There are other tutorials on other courses on this channel. You can also check them out. So have a good day.